Opportunity to present this chapter now, today. This chapter was written with my colleague Jean Guichard, and the title that you can see here is How to Lead an Active Life with Contributing to Sustainable and Equitable Development. So I will try to answer the three questions and present this chapter at the same time. So in this chapter, we point out first that today's world is experiencing various kind of crises, demographic crisis, democratic crisis too, ecological inequalities and so on, but also that these crises are highly interconnected, so that the main active lives, especially in the world of work, produced by this intersectionality of issues, is now the major problem for social justice and more generally for the continuation of life on Earth. The way we all live in the society produces social injustice. Our everyday life, whether we want it or not, produces social injustice. When I buy a book, even the excellent book of Tristan Ronald-Moray, perhaps I contribute to the development of some kind of social injustice in a way I don't even know. That means that social justice can then be seen as a new way of thinking our lives, a way to redefine our forms of life so that we can collectively participate to a sustainable and equitable development. For the key injustice that being addressed, in order to do that, to think of these new forms of lives, we choose and we propose with Jean Guichard, and we discuss it in the chapter, we discuss the question of work. We choose this question of work to think about the social justice because we think that all the major injustices come from the place that work takes in human subjectivity and the place that work organization take into the socio-economic conditions. So we say that the most important key is work and access to decent work. We say that because of the major role played by work is the construction of both the world and the individual subjectivities, and the different forms of organization with which work can give rise to must be evaluated in terms of their potential consequences for the future of the human species. So the main question is, what definitions of work will be better sustain this good for the world? We explain that the discussion around the definition of work can be made into two complementary directions. The first one is a critical view of the work conditions. This is, for example, what is expressed through the notion of decent work developed by the IoT. This definition presents the minimal political and socio-economical conditions that guarantee in all countries the decency of work, which means the respect of human rights at work. This definition suggests that injustice will be reduced only if there is a strong political power that constrains the world of work into this direction. The second direction is a critique coming from various disciplinary fields, but especially from philosophy. It defines what we can call human work. This definition refers to the distinctions between poiesis and praxis made by Aristoteles about human activities. Poiesis is the way work is usually defined as a product, an activity of creation of something that did not exist before. And this product can be exchanged. And in our world, the monetary value of this product is highly dominant in the liberal world. But to define human work, it is necessary to add also a dynamic definition which refers to the process of working, which is called the praxis. And through the praxis, individuals can see this slide. Through the praxis, individuals build an opportunity for constructing and transforming the world and themselves. It is an activity to which they may wish to commit themselves in order to fulfill their potential and to be recognized as a person. As a person, as competent, for instance, but also as a person who participated to the development of a fair world, and so on. For this recognition through work, the economic value of the product of the work is important, but we also need to be recognized from the quality, the beauty of our work, because it's also the way we can be recognized as a good person. So we also need to value the process of working, especially for its capacity to develop equitable forms of life. With this distinction, we can enlarge the definition of work and try to think of which kind of praxis, whether they are paid or not, best help sustainable and equitable human lives, and also which kind of work organization can better allow to develop these praxis. For example, new forms of organization, ethical organization, for example, and social communities that work in a certain way. So how can career guidance contribute to this? First of all, we have to say that career guidance is certainly very resourceless in front of the challenge of global rethinking of human lives. Without a strong political effort to build laws, without an ethical reflection about good and bad work for the society, in parallel, for example, with lobbying activities, without strong popular demand for changes, career guidance will have very small power on these questions of social justice. But because career guidance is at the heart of people's deliberation, people's reflexivity about life and work, it's also a good place to participate to the transformation toward active forms of life. One of the major tools are perhaps critical consciousness and ethical debate about work. Career education is certainly here a big challenge for career guidance field of practice and research, and we must try to develop to education to become an education for active lives, promoting equitable and sustainable development. Its purpose would be to inform young people about the fundamental characteristics of decent and human work in order to help them reflect from such a perspective on their own future working on to claim a universal right that would allow them to lead such active lives. So we think it's important to prepare students to think about their future active lives by wondering how they could individually and collectively contribute to sustainable development through decent work. And from a research perspective, it certainly goes also through more participatory action research design, and this also would be very useful to develop in parallel with some traditional positivist methods this kind of individual and social change. Thank you.